Teaching me Preachers just be in charge of the announcements in heaven. That's one of our gifts, callings, you know, the announcement person. And let me get the announcements. Yes, sir.
Go fishing.
Get to go.
Just go fishing.
We preachers get to go fishing. Amen. That would be awesome. All right, let me line up these announcements for you. Make sure, hey, if you did not get a chance to give to the state missions offering, this is kind of the last call for it. We'll put away the envelopes, all that. It usually runs for the month of September. I know we're here second week of October, but in case you didn't see it, there's still some envelopes that goes to help with lots of different things like disaster relief. I remind you last week with the hurricanes that went through, there's just an immense need. If you have not had a chance to do it, I may show you a clip. My good friend that helped me with video journalism, he was a news reporter at Nashville, and so Todd Dunn, and he was on CNBC or NBC or whatever. So they were doing an interview with him Friday, I believe. So I got a picture of him. I'll have to let y'all see that from the one that just went through. He lives in Sarasota, Englewood area of Florida, and his big thing is of all the stuff that's been damaged, everything now is just shoveling out sand out of people's houses. Shoveling sand out of people's houses. You know, we think about things that we have to shovel. We've been for disaster relief. Some of us have been to the mud outs and recoveries, and you're getting dirt and everything else. But in their area, shoveling sand, that doesn't sound, although the kids like playing in sand, we get them to go. There's a lot of need down there. I still think there's opportunity for us as a church, maybe not right now, but we can get a group and go do some work, whether it be in North Carolina, or anywhere up and down there. It's just been devastated. For the people in Florida, that was two hurricanes within just a little over 2 weeks. Can you imagine if we would be whining and crying if a tornado hit our town 2 weeks apart, wouldn't we? You know, And so you can imagine what they're dealing with. So pray for them, and pray for them that this will be the end of the season, then they can just kind of clean out stuff. So does Ashley, if you're offering any way that you want to help with that, if you want to help with those things, you can put in on the offering envelope and just put under the missions or under other, put disaster relief or hurricane, or you know, we'll know to get that money to there. Then we send on to the Southern Baptist Disaster Relief, and all that money goes to help in the our volunteers that are over there already working, helps resupply them, that kind of thing. Red Cross gets a lot of credit. Now, this used to be the old standby. Red Cross, when people give money to pay for the food, Red Cross really didn't do the cooking. You know who cooks the Red Cross food? Southern Baptist Disaster Relief Cooking Units. So Red Cross is good, but if you give to Southern Baptist, that's going right there. You don't have to worry about administrative costs, everything else. We have like two people that are with our state convention that are paid to lead the disaster relief, and everybody else is volunteer. And so we appreciate the work of those that are going, and be thinking about when we could go or when you want to plug in. If you want to go and you don't want to wait around for the church to organize something like that, and you want to know, I can get you hooked up to where you can go do that disaster relief and how that would work. And I'll be glad to answer those questions from you later. So we're taking up, this is all stuff that we're needing supplies from. So this is kind of an example. We're needing diapers for the Bella Pregnancy Center. Bella Pregnancy Center is supported by San Boy Baptist Association, which we're a member of. It's located in Stigler, and it's a crisis kind of pregnancy, helping women that are pregnant to walk through what they're having to face and how God's going to help them. So on Halloween, they pass out, they're located right on Main Street in Stigler. So they're located, and they give out diapers and other supplies. I think they just said diapers. I don't know if it said wipes on there or not, but small. So don't get these giant things. We want these right here so they can give them out to the ones coming through. So this is a sample. There's a tub in the fellowship hall right in front of the TV that you can put in there. It's labeled diapers, okay? Candy for the trunks of treats. Okay, candy, this is not for you to come here and get samples up here in a minute. Although there's Reese's and Kit Kat. So candy for trunks of treats. There's another tub for that. If you really want to help with the Bella Pregnancy Center, and some of you like being healthy with it, on November 16th, Calvary Baptist Church is doing a 5K, and there's some forms in the hallway here. You can register and help support. It's the first thing. It's not on the PACE program for you that are on PACE. It's not on that, so it's one that you have to pay for, but you can walk it or run it. Marcus Tubbs, y'all know Marcus, does the meet. He's our super runner from Wilberton. You know, almost everybody knows. You remember Marcus. Did you beat Marcus? Did you ever beat him? Yeah. You just didn't run far enough. You did a 5K with Marcus. That's when you won. Marcus, that's like a lot of people say, oh, yeah, I'll beat Marcus in 5. Yeah, but Marcus doesn't. He runs like 15 miles, 20 miles, 30 miles. So Marcus Tubbs, he's kind of our leading that, and with Calvary Baptist, but you can participate. I'd really encourage you. It's on November. It's a Saturday, November 16th. There is a 5K and a 1 mile. And it costs, I don't know what it costs. $20? Is that on here? Anyway, if you want to register, get this form filled out, get it to them. Do they get t-shirts? Do you remember? I don't know if they get. Everybody always gets t-shirts. All right. Okay. Last of the announcements. Oh, hey, we got lunch today? That's great. I'm excited. Thank you all. We've all been bringing food. We're going to have a pastor appreciation. That's for me, I guess, and my wife. Anyway, I want to invite y'all to lunch. I've gone to no expense. You know, actually, I have gone to no expense. I didn't pay anything. And so you all come stay for lunch, so you can come and eat with us, and we'll have a lot of fun. And yes, sir. There's plenty for everybody to have something to eat. So come join us after this. Our annual meeting, for those of you who are messengers, is out at Panola Baptist Church, 2 to 5:30, for the San Boy Baptist Association. This Friday, we're still, Nancy Rowland's family is inviting you to come for a birthday party for her. It says in the bulletin, it's in here, Nancy. says right here, I'm just reading the announcement. Today we'd like to invite you for her 80th birthday party, which she's already had, but celebrating it this Friday, 3 o'clock in the fellowship hall. And so that's for you. And what's that? You did not plan it. That's right. Your kids planned it. I don't know if you're supposed to, I would suppose you could bring. Did they say, did ladies in their class, did they say if we're supposed to bring gifts, gift certificates, cards, I would think at least. Do y'all remember? I don't remember. They didn't tell me what. Yeah, well, whatever y'all want to do.
Hospitality.
Just come and sit here. And this Wednesday night, there's no children's, no Wednesday activities. It's fall break. We're taking a break. We've had a lot of illness, so we're trying to cut through that. And so, our community and everything. So, this Wednesday, no Wednesday activities. It's fall break. Enjoy it. Fall festival's going on as well. Have a good time with that. There's a lot of other things I just mentioned, and that should be plenty for today. All right, brother.
All right, hey, before we come up here, you know, we kind of initiated something last week. Let's get around and shake somebody's hand that we hadn't met before. If you got a COVID worry, do a fist bump or an elbow bump or something. Shake hands with somebody. That's
hey, fist bump.
Yeah.
Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Father, we just come to you, Lord God. We just want to give you a small portion of what you've given us, Father. Accept this as an offering, Father. We just love you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice of the same old lies, if you're trying to feel the same old voice inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, save it. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day and the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. But we've all grown to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker.
Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty.
Says the Lord, every knee will bow to me and every tongue will give praise to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God.
Chosen, not forsaken, I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken.
Heavenly Father, we cannot thank you enough that as we accept you, we are your children. You've got our back, and we just thank you with all of our heart that you've given us a way that we can know you as the Lord of our lives. Thank you that in this place that you're what we're here for. You're our motivation and our purpose, and we love you with all of our hearts. Thank you for the salvation that you've given us. And as always, Father, I pray for those that hadn't made that decision today, that it would be today that they come to know you. Relationships are strengthened as well with you today, realizing that you are our refuge and our solid rock. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
There's a hope for all who want to stray. There's a road for all who lost their way. There's a light that leads us back to grace. Forever shine and never fades. There's a fire stirring in my heart. Since you love
liberty and freedom and what Jesus has given us, man, we should all be shouting and excited about what life has in store, not just in the past, but moving to the future. I just love these thoughts that we've been singing about this morning, and I hope you've heard a lot of these different songs and phrases. Friday night, we got to go and listen to Bobby and the group as they're doing some gospel singing, and it was exciting down at the Senior Center. And just as we think about different ways we can worship the Lord and know that God loves you, sometimes it's, what is that one? It's a not a shadow, not a sigh. You know, I've sang that hymn so many times. And I know that, you know, that there's clouds come. And that cloud was a picture of giving us comfort in the heat. And he said, but there's going to come a time when there's not a shadow, not a cloud, but we're not going to be sighing. Now, I think that's a sign of, it's not a sign, but we're not going to be complaining, you know. So I hope today that when we get through with this word that we find in Romans 14, we're opening up a new chapter. We're going to take two parts to cover a topic that maybe you've not really addressed or thought about in a while. So we'll see how we do with that this week and next week as part of chapter 14. So find Romans 14. And I titled the message Accounting to God. We're all going to give account. And you heard me read just a while ago the very last verse. But we're looking at verses 1 through 12. And before we go into this, I've had two different people ask me to pray or have us pray. And so let's just pause for a minute before I get into the message. Jolene, Gene Saltz's daughter, sent me this text from yesterday and said, good morning, just want to let you know my dad was admitted last night to the Muskogee VA hospital. He has an infection in his foot, and praise God that we caught it before it got into the bone. So Jolene asked for us to pray for Gene Saltz and lift him up in our prayers. He's at the VA in Muskogee. Marines, right? He's a Marine, I believe, if I remember right. And so kind of a theme of the day, I've got another Marine for you to pray for as well. So we're praying for a former Marine, he's retired, you know, all that, with Gene Saltz, and pray for Sheridan Honeycutt. Sheridan's mom's here, and he is on the other spectrum. He's just going through boot camp. Do you know what I'm talking about? Boot camp, that's, do y'all know what that means? It's, we're not talking about going purchasing, looking for boots, okay? He's going through a very difficult time training. And I said the word Marines, you know. Now, I understand a lot of y'all have been, some of y'all have been in different branches and all that stuff, but most of us just think of Marines and boot camp. They're, oh, you're a Marine. Okay? So you went through it. He is, I think, in the last hours of getting through, and I mean, like just hours to finish the boot camp, broke his leg. Four ribs are cracked. Is that right? Broken. And has pneumonia. And within hours of completing boot camp. But that means he needs to get well. And what is he, are they going to let him finish? Or does he start this process all over again? He's got it. His job that he's going to do that he's been recruited for is really a cool job. And so it's a heartbreaker right now. And you know, in boot camp, parents don't really get a lot of, you don't know what's going on. You know, it's kind of a cut off, no one knows until they finish, and then you get to go see them graduate and all that. So we want to pray right now for Sheridan Honeycutt and Gene Saltz and lift them up in prayer. For Sheridan, young man out there stationed out there in California going through this, and that whatever the powers that be will give him whatever it takes to help him get healed up and finish. You know, there's all these rules and regulations and all that stuff. So that's, you know, it's a whole different system than what we go by, right? You know, I'm a pastor for church, and I get to operate with grace and mercy and all that stuff. I don't know if there's grace and mercy in the military, right? So it's going to be maybe it's a miracle. So let's pray for Sheridan. Can you all join with me and Gene right now? Let's join together. You weren't in the Marines, but Delton, you were in the military as well, and you were just telling me about you going through a little medical issue just with your shoulder. But you know what Sheridan is going through. Would you pray for Sheridan especially?
Dear Heavenly Father, we lift up these two, one a veteran of many years and one just beginning his journey. And some of us have been through that and we know the aches and pains, but to get to almost to the finish line and to go through, we know that you will lift him up and bring him through. And be with Jesus as he goes through what he's going through, and he has done many good works in your service, Lord. These gentlemen and all veterans and all soldiers out there now, we lift them up in prayer. And just be with them in compassion, love, and healing when they need it, Lord. Thank you for all you do. Thank you for the love. And pray, Jesus, you be with them in all things. Amen.
Some of you who are in the military and you know what's more than what we will ever really know on this boot camp and all that stuff. So I'd ask implore you to take this into your prayer these next few days so that this will get through. And I know that would be appreciated from the family because they're right now they're just going, we don't know what's happening other than this. So we want to pray for Sheridan through these next few days and hopefully we'll give you some good report of what's happened. And if for whatever reason, if he has to start all over, then we just pray for that. But that's not what we're praying for. Praying for healing, praying for he'll be able to finish this and move on. Yeah, yeah. Yes, mom's out. Mom's going like, I don't know. How do we contact? Is there someone we can call? Is there somebody we can plead with? And she said, no, we don't have that. You know, it's a problem. So what if we know someone out there and we call? You know, you can get in as much trouble as Sheridan could get as much trouble by us trying to intervene in his behalf.
Yeah, we did that.
You know? And so if you do that, that's not always the best. So we'll let him intervene in his way in the life of this young man. And let him get the glory for what happens through your pleading on his behalf to Him. You got the picture?
Yes.
That's the power. You all have the power because the Lord hears your prayers. He does. He has set you free to pray whenever you want to the Father. You have got that liberty to talk to the Father. And so let's read this passage on liberty for a minute. And let's just see how we apply it into our lives so that we can work this out in the life of our church, the life of our way of thinking about things. So you've been set free in Christ. Let's read this verse. I read the last few verses a minute ago during the song. I love that little part in that song. It's always a timing thing. I try to use the scripture that I'm preaching on somewhere in there. Boy, it just plugged this one and all the ones I've done. This one just plugged right into this song that we were just singing. It was amazing. I thought, wow, this is like this passage was built for that song. So y'all found Romans 14, verse 1. Accept anyone who is weak in faith, but don't argue about doubtful issues. We could just start. We should not argue. Church members, stop arguing about, here's a good guy. Stop arguing about doubtful issues. If we're not careful, we'll spend all our time discussing and debating, arguing about things that are trivial in nature. That really should not be a part of what we do in our life. Paul says, one person believes he may eat anything, but one, and so you got to get this a picture of two groups, two sides, if you want to. Man, it sounds like this is going to be another issue dealing with politics and again, getting away from politics. Seems like we're always, if we're not careful, we can always go into one side or another. Okay? And if you're not careful, you can build a faction or groups that support your side. So there is one person that believes, one type believes that he may eat anything, but one who is weak. So that person is what we call the person that's strong in their faith. They can eat anything. Then there is another group, another person who is weak in his faith. Not because he's eating only, he's not weak because this person's only eating vegetables. So when you're reading that, right? One person believes he may eat anything, strong. Another, one who is weak eats only vegetables. Weak. Let's talk about their faith. And so let's unwrap that a little bit more. Let's think through that. One who eats must not look down on one who does not eat. Looks down. See them as inferior, if you would. And one who does not eat must not criticize one who does. Because God has accepted him. God's accepted us, okay? This whole passage is about our standing in front of God. Jesus Christ is our Lord. Keep on reading. Who are you, verse 4, to criticize another's household slave? Before his own Lord, he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. So in this little parentheses, verse 4, parentheses, dealing with slavery for just a second, servanthood, just a second, in a home. You are outside of the home, and what's happening in this home, you do not have the right to criticize what that servant is doing or not doing. Because the servant in that other home, if you would say the employee, if you want to do it that way, the employee of that home gives account to the boss, or in this case, the master of the home. So I'm out here in my own household. You don't have the right to criticize how a servant responds or works to that Lord or master or boss in that other place. So that's kind of a parenthesis here. That's kind of like a picture, an example for us in this discussion. Keep on reading with me. Then he says, one person considers one day to be above another day. Someone else considers every day to be the same. Each one must be fully convinced in his own mind. Whoever observes a day, he observes it to honor, or he observes it for the honor of the Lord. Whoever eats, eats for the Lord, since he gives thanks to God. And whoever does not eat, it is for the Lord that he does not eat, yet he thanks God. For none of us lives to himself, and no one dies to himself. If we live, we live for the Lord. And if we die, we die for the Lord. This verse 8 is a great guideline for us in practical everyday living in Christ. If we live, we live for the Lord. If we die, we die for the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Who do we belong to?
The Lord.
To the Lord. And so if you need to fill in the blank, we're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, don't be confused by that little parenthesis of example dealing with the Lord there. We're talking about the Lord. If we live or we die, we belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because Christ, verse 9, Christ died and came to life for this, that he might rule over both the dead and living. Can I do a little personal pet peeve right now? But some of our songwriting in the past and some of our current songwriting sometimes does something that makes me just irritated. And can I just pause for just a second here? I want you to know that Jesus Christ is not a robber. There's a real popular song out here by a very popular group that I know is going on. And I dislike when they say that Jesus is a grave robber. Okay? Jesus, because robbing is against the law. Stealing is against the law. And what Jesus did, he had full authority. Jesus didn't come to rob death or steal from Satan. Jesus has full authority. And he has all authority. And so he does not have to steal, sneak in, or rob. So when we write our songs, and that may ruin a song for you, but I sometimes critique because I'm a preacher. And then I have to critique my own songs. And then I get mad at myself for critiquing something that I used to love to sing. But then I understand they're written by humans for a purpose. And sometimes that's what fits into the lyrics. I understand that. But let's just make sure we don't put the lyrics of a song that is popular above what the scriptures teach. And the scriptures teach very clearly here that he, Jesus Christ, came, he died, he came to life for this, that he might rule, having authority over both the dead and the living. But you, why do you criticize your brother? Or you, why do you look down on your brother? This is the two camps dealing with whether they should eat or whether they should not eat. Whether they should value one day as being more important than another day. He says, why do this? For we will all stand before the tribunal of God. I'm going to say the rest of that for just a second. And let's just think through this really carefully for us. If we're not careful in our determining what we should or not should not do as Christians, we can get a little bent out of shape and become very legalistic. So our liberty is not a freedom to sin. The Apostle Paul has been very clear throughout Romans, all these preceding chapters. But he also says we have been given grace, we've been set free, we have liberty. This passage, addressing the Jewish Christians in Rome, is dealing with now that they are believers in Christ, and they're in that early church in Rome, and many of them were Jewish, and some later were Gentiles that became saved. So you had this two groups in there. This may or may not be dealing with the meat offered to idols, as in other passages and other letters from the Apostle Paul. But it is probably addressing the issue, now that we are followers of Jesus Christ, do we still have to follow the Mosaic law related to certain types? In other words, can they eat bacon? I'm not trying to trivialize it. But But it was a very serious thing. It's what set them apart, the Jewish people. They could not eat pork. And there was other things they could not eat as well. And so there were the Gentiles that became Christian that said, now that we've been set free in Christ, yeah, we can still eat meat, because they never had a hold on us and our belief. And there were some Jewish Christians that said, now we've been set free. The Apostle Paul would be a prime example, because he would be there saying that he knows he can eat. And even the Apostle Peter, remember, was given that vision, how God said to him, no, you don't call any of this stuff unclean anymore. And really dealing with the Gentiles coming to be a part of the kingdom of God, but also dealing with what they could eat. Remember that passage in Acts. So, do you have a church set up in Rome, the church of the meat eaters and the church of the veggies, the vegans, the vegetarians? Is there what this is not what this is about? This is not saying we look down people that just eat vegetables and those that will eat anything. This is about a religious belief system, and many of them from the Jewish faith. And so no matter where you fit in this, some would say, I've been set free, and don't you try to. I'll look down on you, because your faith is not as strong as mine. And those that were weak in the faith would criticize, well, you're not as holy as we are. Have we not heard that term, holy rollers? Have we not heard of different denominations and groups of Christians that would look down at others because, we can start listing a whole bunch of things. Those have been around church life for a while. And we can say a lot of things, from what we wear to different things. And it's not just Christianity. You go into the Muslim world, and you can go parts of the world where you can see people that are in different stages of what they wear. Primarily the women, what they are supposed to wear, from completely in black, nothing seen but their eyes. And even that you may not be able to see very. And so even within the Muslim faith, within the Muslim teachings, very strict to that, to just having a head guard or not quite as covered. So we have to be careful that in our faith practice, following Jesus Christ, that we are, what we are expecting of others is not what Jesus expects. Because Jesus is the Lord. Now, I'm not given a license for us to all come in bikinis and really skimpy outfits, okay? Because there's passages that talk about what we should do in modesty. Okay, so there's a lot of things that the scripture is very clear. So let the scriptures guide us. Not just in what we wear. Not just, you know, does that mean that it's okay to smoke tobacco but not marijuana? The law seems to be saying now we can do marijuana, you know? And you know, I go to a time where that was, you know, I saw friends go to jail because they smoked marijuana. And now you can go get a license for anything, it seems like. So where do we go with all of this stuff? Okay? So part of it is looking at what does the scripture teach? What does the scriptures teach?
Amen.
What is your responsibility to God? Looking in the Word. And Paul's going to give more information to us at the end of this as well. But in here, he starts with, and this is a very good foundation for all of us, what is it that Jesus calls you to do? And it appears in his opening verses that Jesus gives you in your conscience the work of the word that God is speaking to you about and how you're to live. He's asking you to follow him. Whether you be a person that says, I cannot eat bacon. And it's not because of what's in it. It's got loaded in salt or whatever it may be for you. It's not because of that. But for these people, he said, if the Holy Spirit and the Word is calling you to do this, then you follow that. But you don't condemn or criticize someone that says, no, I have the freedom to eat pork, or I have the freedom to eat shrimp. You know? Now, Brother Paul, you're getting a little bit crazy now. You're taking away my shrimp. You're taking away my bacon. You're taking away, you know, well, that's what this one group would do. But if the Lord declares to you to be obedient to something that he's teaching you, then I'm not going to criticize you, but you're not going to condemn me. So that's the whole teaching here. It's the connecting you to what is the Lord doing in your life with some teachings. So let the Lord guide you. Let him use, and we will respect that in the church. Some of the teachings, some of the themes that I've heard is that there are essential things of the faith that we are going to be united in and we're going to follow. There are some non-essentials to the faith that you have liberty in. And so that's what we distinguish. If you tell me, Brother Paul, I have liberty because I believe Jesus is one way to be saved, I would say then you're out of line with the scripture and out of line with Jesus, because Jesus said he is the what? The way. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. There's no other way to the Father except through Jesus. So we know that the scriptures teach that the essential to our faith is we are saved by faith in Jesus and Jesus alone.
Amen.
Now how we live that faith may change. I took groups of people to Africa, to the Muslim world, and I saw the women that would go with us. There would be some men and some women. And I saw the women, out of respect and deference to the Muslim ladies they were trying to connect to, that they would wear, not the whole black thing, but they would wear coverings for their heads. Did they have to do that? No. There is no Muslim over there that would look down. They would just disrespect them. They didn't know it. They'd disrespect them, but they know that they were Americans, and Americans are totally loose in their morals. I mean, that's how they would look at it. But the women wanted to be able to connect. It is not hypocrisy on your part to go to a brother or sister in Christ and to eat a meal in their home, and if they say, we do not, you know, that we do not eat this meat or whatever, then you go, I demand you feed me bacon. We'll stay with the bacon theme for today. Then you don't have to demand it. It's not hypocrisy. It's a love for your brother or your sister in Christ that you honor and you do that. Okay? It'd be like, you know, what was it when we grew up? Women had to wear their dress. They had to wear a dress to church. In the day when I grew up, had to wear a dress. And I remember where it used to have to cover their ankles. And there's still churches that do that. Okay? I see all you women, a lot of you are wearing pants to church. Oh my goodness. You know, if you had done that when I was a kid, what would you have been laughed at? You'd be like, oh, did you see? She wore pants to church. Right? Am I wrong? Isn't that right? I just talked about last week, you know, did you see that preacher? He didn't have a tie on. I'm sorry. Okay. I snuck out another time.
You couldn't even wear pants to school until I was in third grade.
Well, but you're old like me. Yeah, that's right. Girls had to wear dresses to school. My, no one in America is going downhill. Is that what it is? No. It's not that. But Paul's saying this right here. So let me wrap this up, because I know. What is it? This is an unusual message for today, but it's where Paul is. And so we're going to stick with where Paul's been teaching from the Holy Spirit. So let me just get you back up to where we were, where I read that in just a while ago. So the bottom line in trying to determine how we live and how we work along with others, the bottom line is you don't criticize someone else's faith where they are because they don't have as much freedom as you do. And if you have a strong liberty in Christ because you have a strong faith, in other words, more connection to the Lord about certain things that the Lord said you have freedom to do, you don't look down on someone. So within our family, we don't criticize and we don't look down or judge others. You don't walk with an air of superiority that you are better. The Apostle Paul is very clear here. He says, we all recognize that one day we will, every one of us individually, stand before the tribunal of God. We'll stand before the judgment seat of Christ, not for your salvation or eternal existence with God. That has already been determined because of your faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You are secure in Christ because the essential to your faith is that Jesus is the Son of God who came and lived among us, lived a perfect life, died on the cross, was buried, rose again, stands at the right hand of the Father, has given all authority, has been given all authority, and passed on the Great Commission to the church, and we have responsibilities to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we will one day stand before Jesus and give an account. That's what it says here in verse 12. So then each of us, that means fill in your name, so then Paul Brady will give an account of himself to God, to the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? And y'all are like, yeah, you go, Paul. Guess what? You get your turn. Everyone's. Now, I've told you, as a pastor, pastors have, and other scriptures teach this, pastors have a responsibility to the Lord Jesus Christ as a shepherd of a flock, of a church. So I have a response. I will give an account of myself and for this church, for the time where I've led this church. You don't. So when I get on to you, I have to, like a coach has to. Okay? So if I offend you, I know what Jesus told me to do. So I'm going to do my very best to help us with this. Okay? But I want you to know, you will not get caught off guard, because on, what is today? October the 13th, 2024, Pastor Paul Brady, I'll be able to tell Jesus this. And he may say that. He said, I told you to preach this and you didn't. So I'm checking the list here. You in Christ will stand before Jesus Christ and give an account for what you have done with Jesus and for Jesus in obedience to the commands of Jesus Christ. That would include, are you critical of other believers? Do you look down on other believers? Or are you remembering that you have a call to love your brother and your sister in Christ? And where they are and where you are may be at different places. So we walk together in this church. If we're in sin, we have responsibility to call our brothers and sisters to an account. If we're sinning, this is not a discussion of sinful matters. Please hear me. Don't say, you can't judge me because that passage right there gives me freedom to do whatever I want. Your freedom in Christ is not a freedom to do anything you want. But there are some areas of belief that are not a spot where we can judge each other. That's what Paul's talking about. So you can be a vegetarian. You can be a full-blown carnivore of any kind of wild animal you want to eat that won't make you sick. You can say, I believe we should observe and hold holy, not just the Sabbath, but every other holy day that was set apart in the Old Testament. Remember, if you go with the Sabbath as being something that you're going to really stick everything about on your bandwagon of Christianity, you better get with all the other feasts and festivals that were done too. You've got to study with all of them. You can't just pick the one. But there's another group that said, we believe every day is holy before the Lord God. That's what Paul is saying here. Days. One day or every day. All types of food or just vegetables. Which church do you want to join? I want to join the church where Jesus Christ is Lord. And he set me free. He set me free to serve him. And I am obedient to him. And one day I will stand before him. And that's the question for you. Are you ready to stand before Jesus on that day? Some of you may be here going, I'm not ready to stand before God because I'm not even giving Jesus Christ first place in my life. Now's the day. If you're not in Jesus Christ, you will not stand in front of the judgment seat of Christ. You will stand before God, and you will be separated out, and you will be set aside. And Miss Bobby, in case you didn't hear this, make sure you're tuned in here. Don't ever judge preachers. Because sometimes, let me tell you, sometimes people don't hear pastors talk about heaven and hell because most people do not attend church. And most Christians are so rare in their attendance of church. When they say, I never hear the preacher preach on heaven and hell, and I'll say it's because you've only been here 6 times in the year. Right?
Right.
Okay. So if you're not in Christ, you will be set apart and sent to hell to spend the rest of eternity separated from God. But if you're in Jesus Christ, you will stand before Him. Are you ready to stand before Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and give account for yourself and what you said about other believers and what you've done with the gospel of Jesus Christ? Are you ready? Let's pray. Lord, I just pray right now that as we think about these things today, that you will give us direction for how we are to live, not from the past, but from the day starting today, moving forward with Jesus Christ and following His will and what He's called us to do. Lord, please forgive us where we've been hypercritical, air of superiority over other believers. And help us from this day forward to remember to focus on You and to walk with our brothers and sisters to bring Jesus Christ to this world. For it's in His name we pray. Amen. Lord, spoken to you. You come right now. As we stand to sing, you come to Jesus Christ.
Oh, so are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and light for abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Come right now. Come to Jesus.
Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory.
Come now, come right now, come to Jesus.
Through death into life everlasting, He passed and we follow Him there. Over us in no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are.
Turn your eyes.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Y'all have a seat. You know, as we think about these things, keep reading the scripture. There are other passages that connect with this and teaching, not just about what we should eat and what we should observe, but how we should operate, how we should connect with brothers and sisters in Christ. And you just know that there are some that are strong in their faith because they've been walking. And just because you've been walking for a long time, it means that you've totally got it all together. So let's all work together and work alongside each other and just be preparing yourself to where you will stand before Jesus. Yes, I think He's going to hug you. Yes, I think he's going to welcome you. Yes, I think you're going to have an amazing time. But just know that there is an accounting. That's the term today. There is an accounting that you will give to the Lord. You've got to know that. Okay? You can't escape it. And reality is, it should be one of joy. Lord, thank you for letting me serve you with all that you gave to me. And in that moment, may God bring joy to his life. Pray for Teresa and I. This Tuesday, Christy and our family, we had a young man that was a part of our life. Christy's really good friend, Crystal, her older brother, passed away last Sunday. And he had struggled with addictions and had just come out of it maybe 3 or 4 years ago. He came and spoke to us a few years ago and helped us when we were just getting into trying to feed the homeless and that kind of thing. So Mike Pond came. And so he passed away like a heart attack. Last Sunday. And so his funeral is Tuesday. There's going to be a lot of people there. A lot of people. Some from his past. A lot from his past. Some from Hope is Alive that are in the midst of struggling through addictions and recuperating and recovering. And so his family, his sister is like one of our, she's like one of our daughters. Kind of thing, Crystal, and their family. So they've been a part of our family for a long time. And so we're going to need to speak and talk to them at First Baptist in Claremore this Tuesday afternoon. So I just didn't ask for your prayers as I'm not able to speak. The family wants me to offer an altar call and bring people to Christ. That would be bring great glory. And so it's just a lot of story behind that with Michael Hahn. And you've got enough time. Long time ago, at a church in Tulsa, we took a huge group of youth to Falls Creek to camp. And my daughters, it was a lot of their friends, a lot of them. We came back, I think it was 15 or 18 that got saved, got to baptize 15. These were some wild kids. This was back in the 90s, and they were wild. They really were wild kids. They didn't have a lot of background in church. And it would be like some of our boys now in teenage life. And I mean, I had some jumping in the baptistry when I was baptizing. I mean, they were so excited about being baptized. They would just jump. They didn't do the steps. They'd skip the steps. I mean, the water's splashing everywhere. It's that kind of thing. And at Mike Hahn, there was a whole crowd of them. They were on drugs and all sorts of stuff. And during the week, me and the youth director, we were going through our bunks. And all of a sudden, this some kind of paraphernalia falls down on the floor, drug paraphernalia. And so my youth guy knew youth a lot more than I was. And we had, oh man, we had spiritual war that night. And we were at the point of deciding whether we were going to send these kids home, call the drug sniffing highway patrol to come in, all that stuff. And they finally broke down. Confessed everything, we kept them there. This was early on the week, and then almost all of them came to Christ. It was amazing what God did. And so that happened there. And then there was stuff that happened while we were gone out of state. And then we come back, reconnect with Mike, and then we got to see him in coming to Christ, you know, out of addiction. And what God was doing through his ministry to people that he was on the streets with. So Michael Hahn wants us to present that gospel to those friends that may be there. So this is going to be quite a different type of funeral Tuesday. I ask your prayers for Sheridan Honeycutt, Gene Saltz, and the family of Michael Hahn, and your pastor and his wife as we minister. And that would be, that's how we would know we are fully appreciated as pastor and wife. Because this is like our family. And that's a little sermon in the sermon. So, Brother Rusty, you're in charge now.
All right, Hank. Hey, I'm going to pray for our food here. And I hope everybody makes a way to get over there and show our appreciation to the pastor. But I want to say a few words before we do. You know, we have